Morning.
Good morning.
Boy, we must all be angry. We're scattered out. Like we're mad at each other.
We can do like Sunday night and everybody move to the back three rows.
Back three rows. Good morning to everyone, if I didn't already say so. Thankful for God's blessings. One thing about getting older is you get forgetful. Denise and I, we record a TV program. We had three or four programs recorded that we hadn't had a chance to watch, so. But we'd watched a couple, but we couldn't remember which ones we'd watched, so we started watching. And even as we was watching, we wasn't sure if we'd watched this one. So, you know, every day's a new day. You don't remember what happened the day before, so. Plus, I've learned that getting old, being forgetful is God's way of making old people exercise. Because I go back to the house three or four times before I get gone because I forgot something. Yesterday at the fall festival, I went back and forth from the car because Denise had forgot things. So, gives me good exercise, I guess. I'm not sure. But have you noticed that I was thinking of the old Hee-Haw show. Any of y'all remember the old Hee-Haw show?
Oh, yeah.
Gloom, despair, agony on me. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Blue, despair, agony on us all.
Don't give up your preaching now.
You don't think I'll make it in the singer's world? Well, on Hee-Haw, you didn't have to be real good. I heard you all laughing. Ah, the world we're living in. Have you noticed that it's full of gloom and despair? It just seems like agony everywhere. I listened to the news this morning for a little bit before I left the house, and 11 people, you know, usually you hear two or three, but this morning 11 people had been shot in St. Louis last night. Two had left home threatening suicide. They were on the hunt for these individuals. Almost every day you hear of evil and wickedness. Sometimes it feels like, if not all the time, that we're losing the battle that we're fighting as Christians. But I thought, what a blessing, and how ungrateful sometimes Christians are. But what a blessing, and the blessings of salvation that we have. Just think about the wonderful blessings of salvation. We have so much to be joyful for every day of our lives, over and over again. We as Christians, we can know the joy of salvation. And our salvation comes to us by grace through faith. It's a gift that we receive from God through the shed blood of God's Son, Jesus Christ. So, 1 Peter chapter 1 this morning is some scripture I'd like to read. Peter was kind of in a day, I think, much like we are today. Sometimes we feel like we're privileged to be in the worst of all days. You know, the world's been in the worst of all days almost from the beginning of creation. Man has been wicked and evil and fought against God. And I think that here Peter was in a day much like we are living in. So he felt a need here to encourage the people that he was ministering to. I'm going to start with verse 3. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season it need be, you are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than that of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise, honor, and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love, in whom though now ye see him not, you believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable, full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. I believe the Spirit of God had inspired Peter to write these words to these people there in this time, because they were going through difficult times in life. And he comes down to a point here where he wants to remind them of the regeneration, their salvation, and the redemption that they had received in Christ Jesus. So I would like to look just for a few minutes at this passage beginning here, and it's the one that I want to highlight, where Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So Peter is reminding us, in all the trials and the tribulations of life, in the midst of all the wickedness that's happening in the world, and everything that's taking place around us, no matter what, that we have a lively hope. Amen. It's according to his abundant mercy. I think that he's telling us and reminding us of our new birth in Christ Jesus. This morning, God has given us a new birth. And it's a birth that has been brought about by the lively hope that we receive from the resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, from the dead. Scripture says, being born again, not of the corruptible seed, but by the incorruptible Word of God that lives and abides forever. You know, think about it. We have been born again unto a newness of life. God says that he came unto his own, but his own received him not, but to as many as received them, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, being born not of the flesh, nor of the will of man, nor of the will of the flesh, but we were born of the Spirit of the one true living God. So I think one of the first characteristics, one of the first things that happens to us when we first receive Christ as our Lord and Savior, is we receive this living hope in our hearts and lives. All of a sudden, we begin to display the fact that, hey, I have a lively hope in Christ Jesus, that no matter what happens, God is keeping me safe, he's made me promises, and I am alive forever. So I think it is always and forever this lively hope is in our hearts working and displaying itself. It becomes, as Paul says here, it becomes an anchor to our souls in the storms of life. He says in Hebrews 6 and 19, which hope we have as an anchor of our soul, both sure and steadfast, which entereth in to the veil. So we have this lively hope as we are born again by the Spirit of God, that we receive this anchor that puts us firm. I've heard people say, well, how do Christians endure some of the hardships that they're going through in life? And it's because of this lively hope that we have in us through the new birth, that we become a child of God and we receive this. It's an anchor that will hold us steadfast during trials of life. That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of the promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. But now, receive God. We have this precious and living hope. See, the world is such a hopeless place. You walk into the bookstores and books are being written about how hopeless the world is and how to overcome the hopelessness through worldly and manly things. And it's just everywhere you look, you watch a movie and it's filled with a sense of hopelessness. As they look at our world, they think it's hopeless. They're simply reflecting this sense of hopelessness that people worldwide seem to be experiencing. People feel this sense of hopelessness. Have you felt this spirit that I'm speaking about in our world today, that you just feel like people have a sense of it's hopeless? You hear of many today that are buying old missile
silos.
Thank you, Brother Mitch. And they're turning them into survivalists. You hear these preppers that are getting ready for the world to come to total destruction, but somehow they're going to survive, and they'd like to sell us some survival food so during the difficult times you can live on a little longer in your little hole in the ground, eat your beans out of the can. Wonder what kind of life it would be. And they capitalize on this fear that the world is experiencing, because people flock in herds, if you would have it that way, to buy these things and be engulfed in these things. You get out in the crowds around the world and you listen to many young people and you begin to realize that, hey, there's a generation out there, church. There's a generation of young people, and it's growing more and more as these children grow up. They grow up with the attitude that there's no answers. There's no solutions, so what's the use? This is one of the reasons that so many young people are committing suicide today. They come to a point to where it's just, what's the use? It's hopeless. There's no answer. You see, there's a world of people out there that's hopeless in their hearts. They're trying in this world somehow to find hope, happiness, and they look for it in immorality. They look for it in sex. They look for it in alcohol. They look for it in drugs. They look for it in all the areas that Satan tempts them with. They try to end this hopeless feeling that they have. So they want a future. They look for an expectation of the future. You know, when we lose sight of a future, then we begin to grow hopeless. Some of us have felt a little hopelessness in the fact as we are looking at the future of our church. And as we look to the future and we can't really see what we want to see, then we get a hopeless feeling. And this is the feeling that the world has as they look to the future of our world. There's hopelessness. But there's only one place where a person can find a living hope. And we know where that's at, church. That's in Christ Jesus, God's Son. That's in having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. This verse speaks about three things here as we think about a living hope. And I'm amazed at how it tells us and how the strength of this hope is. Our hope as Christians is super duper strong. It's like a super glue, if you would have it. He says that the strength of our hope has been found in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, God's Son. The basis of the gospel that we are called to proclaim to a lost and dying world, that Jesus Christ, God's Son, came into the world, lived a sinless life, died on the cross for our sins, but was raised again in a resurrection of life, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for us. see, a hope can only be as strong as what it's based on. And when we base our hopes on something that has no strength, then our hope becomes weak, deteriorated, and falls apart. But the Christian faith this morning, brothers and sisters, it stands upon the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, God's Son. Paul tells us if Jesus rose again from the dead, then we have a hope that is indeed alive. But if Christ didn't rise from the dead, then our hope is worthless, useless, has no strength. He says, and if Christ be not risen there, then our preaching is vain. Why do we waste our time if Christ hasn't risen? He says also, hey, Christ didn't rise from the dead, your faith also is vain. And guess what? We are still all in our sins. But the beauty is, as we know, and history has proved it, and the Spirit of God has revealed it to us, that Christ Jesus, God's Son, was delivered to death for our offenses, but he was raised again by God for our justification. Those of us that believe in him, experience him in our hearts and in our lives through the Spirit of God. You see, there's a substance that this hope is based with. 1 Peter 1:4 says, to an inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved for you in heaven. Wow. We have an inheritance. An inheritance is a benefit or a blessing that's been given to us by someone who cared enough for us, usually. Some of us have received inheritance from our family. And it's usually received because we are a member of a family. We didn't do anything to deserve it. We were just born. Some folks receive a big inheritance and others just receive a minor inheritance, and some really don't receive any at all in worldly terms. It's not anything that we earned or even that we deserve. Inheritance is something that you get. It is a possession that is yours. Maybe even out there in the future, our families can see an inheritance waiting for them when we pass. Wow. Because, think of it, the inheritance, as a child of God, is far greater than anything that we could ever inherit in our earthly life. No matter how much money someone had received, no matter what monumental items and possessions may have been passed down from generations, our heavenly inheritance is way beyond and above anything that we could imagine in earthly terms. It's said to be incorruptible. That means it's not subject to decay. Not like the things of the world. We can get a nice, new, bright, shiny car, and pretty soon it's beat up, banged, and rusty. We can build a nice, fine, new home, and pretty soon the roof's leaky. All of our worldly possessions are subject to rot and decay. The inheritance that we may be waiting on in worldly terms can rot down and fall away. Man, have you seen the horrible tragedies in California, the homes and possessions being burned? I heard over, I can't remember the number. It was in the thousands of homes that have been burned up and destroyed. And people dying. This world can destroy earthly inheritance. But our heavenly inheritance in Christ Jesus is incorruptible. And it also says undefiled. That means it cannot be polluted or ruined even by us, that it's perfect and pure. And it will always be that we can't destroy it, we can't pollute it, we can't make it bad. It's there perfectly undefiled. And this is one of the good points that Peter says. Hey, listen, this is why you should have joy in your new birth. It will not ever fade away.
Amen.
That means it's ours, church, forever. We can't lose it, or it cannot ever be stolen away from us. We can lose things here on this earth and prized possessions. If you ever lost something, you know the feeling of losing something precious to you. May not be of great value. People have lost rings and billfolds and all sorts of things we lose. And sometimes we diligently search for them. And I've heard stories of someone finding someone's ring that they lost 50 years ago, not too long ago, and they turned it into a person and they were still excited. But we can't lose this inheritance that Christ has given us. Think about the security of this hope. I love this. You know, wife and I occasionally, when we're traveling, we love to eat at Lambert's. But let me tell you that you're going to be standing in line for a long time. Doesn't matter when you go there, when we're there anyway, when we're traveling, it'll be an hour wait. But in some restaurants, you can make a reservation. And you'll say, I'm going to be here at a certain time. And they'll make a reservation for you. Have you ever been standing at a restaurant waiting in line and someone come in and they get them and take them right in? Kind of frustrating. Well, I was here first. Yeah, we made a reservation. But the point is, this inheritance is reserved in heaven for us. That means that it's already there. We have this inheritance today as children of God. It's already there. It's simply waiting for us to come. And when we get there, we will be taken right in because we have reserved our inheritance through Christ Jesus by becoming a child of God, accepting Him as our Savior.
Amen.
I think that's special. It's waiting for me right now. Reserved. It is the most secure inheritance that any person could ever have. It's not going anywhere. It's reserved in heaven. Verse 6, here Peter begins to speak about an enduring faith. Man, there's a reality, church, in suffering. I tell you what, very few of us will get out of this life without some suffering. We all have to endure. These Christians here that Peter was speaking to were enduring unbelievable trials and troubles. They were being persecuted because they believed in Jesus Christ. Nero, one of the rulers of that day, had blamed them for the city of Rome being burned. And this resulted, according to history, in unexplainable trials. Some of the Christians, they claim, were being sewn in sacks and threw out into an arena where wild hogs would trample and devour them. Some of them were being rolled in tire and pitch and were being put in the Garden of Nero, history says, and they were being burned as torches. We hear a lot of troubles and trials that our missionaries today in the world are going through. Preachers and missionaries being thrown in prison, being persecuted in all types of ways. And sometimes things just look horrible. But Peter writes here to encourage these people even in the midst of trials and tribulations that they were going through. Now, some of us, we don't always suffer some of the things that these people suffered. But these people, when they became a Christian, they were immediately became an enemy to the government. Peter says, wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye in heaviness through manifold temptations. Manifold temptations. Wow. Think about that. Temptation means trials. It means troubles. It means hardships. All kinds of difficulties. Talking here about the types of troubles that were coming into the Christian life. These people, they were suffering many, many things. Manifold! In other words, there was a lot of different things, many difficult things, not just one, but manifold temptations were being hammered on them. All kinds of troubles. And Peter uses the same word here to describe the grace of God in chapters 4 and 10. The manifold grace. So, what's the point? It has to be a point. For every kind of temptation and trouble we may experience in life, God has a grace to supply the help that we need to deal with it. He says, with every temptation, there is a way of escape provided for us. And listen to what he says about the reason. One of the things we often question is, why? Why? Why does God allow these troubles? Why do these things happen? Have you ever asked the question, why? Even Jesus, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me as he died on the cross of Calvary? Why? It's something that we just simply ask many times. He says, those trials need be. What he is saying is there is a need to be about trials. There is a purpose in trials in life. God uses them for a purpose. And we're told that God uses everything to the good of them that love the Lord, to those called according to his purpose that we experience in life. There is a reason, brothers and sisters, for the troubles that we go through. And we go through them nearly every day. He uses an illustration as being like gold. Another thing that they try to scare us with today, when you mention the word gold, some investors are saying our 401ks, if we have one, or our retirements, if you're lucky enough to retire, wanting to be consumed by the government, by gold. Another fear of life that we're entering into a time, whoa, it's hopeless. My future investments are going to be hurled away some way through the government. By gold. Hear it every day on the radio. But Peter uses the illustration of gold being put into the fire. So if you're going to buy gold, make sure that it's been purified through the fire. Because this is how God uses our troubles in life as Christians. He's telling that it's a process of purification for us, like gold being tested in a fire. When you put gold in a fire, it begins to burn away the dross and the impurities, and it becomes pure gold. And no one will want to invest in 50% purity of gold bars. They usually say 99.9% pure gold. So God is using the Christian trials in life to purify us as a Christian, to make us like gold that has been tested in a fire. Have you ever seen someone go through a very difficult time in life, and how when they come through that time in life, they come out on the other side much purer in their Christian faith? Their faith hasn't been destroyed, but it's been multiplied and strengthened. Fire can't destroy gold, it just purifies it. And Peter tells us that's exactly the purpose of trials in the life of a believer. God allows these problems and difficulties to come into our life so that we can have a stronger, pure faith. In that our faith might be found into the praise and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. One of these days, the Lord will come. I believe it with all my heart that one day Jesus Christ is going to return, and he's going to say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," to those of us that have struggled in the Christian life, to those of us that have attempted to be faithful. He say, "Well, you've been faithful over a few things. Come and inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Our inheritance, incorruptible, undefiled, reserved in heaven for us." And Peter says in verse 8, Who having not seen ye love, in whom though now ye see him not, yet believing ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. And someone even wrote a song about joy unspeakable and full of glory. Heard that song. Seen Savior. We can't see Jesus with our physical eyes. Peter had seen Jesus Christ, the person, with his eyes. He had witnessed the bodily person of Jesus. And he grew to love him with all of his heart. He had known and experienced the love of Christ in the flesh. But these believers, like us, that he was writing to here, they had not had that privilege of seeing the Lord in the flesh. But still, they loved him. And to many, that's an unexplainable love. How can we love someone that we haven't seen? We love Jesus Christ by faith. And Peter is talking about a wonderful thing here, that we can love someone that we've never seen. We can love someone that we've never seen in the flesh. Yeah. I thought about that and wondered, how is that really possible, to love somebody that we've never seen? But us parents, do you remember that you loved your children even before they were born? I remember having a special feeling and desire about my children, even before I knew them, even before they come into the world. I had this wonderful feeling in the expectancy of parent about my children. I love them. I would do anything for them, even before they were born. And that's also true of my grandchildren. I felt that same feeling of anticipation and love even before I knew who they were. I think that's one of the wonderful things of salvation, eternal life. It brings into our life a captivating love. And really, church, this is the key to the Christian life, is this love. Loving Jesus. And you've heard me say many times that the first thing that we're required is to love God. Jesus is God. We're to love Him with all of our hearts. We're to love Him with all of our mind, with all of our souls, with all of our strength. The very first thing that we are to do is to love God. He felt it so important that when we started this action items here, that we put it before everything else at the end. And this was one of the end items, but we moved it all the way to the top. That if we would put God first, if we would love God as we are supposed to love God, we wouldn't even be discussing any of the other items. So, do we love Him? Let's ask ourselves that question. Do we love God? Sometimes I don't think he feels that love. Or we express that love. You know, this is really all that Jesus really basically wants from us. When we ask, what does God want from me? What does Jesus expect of us in return for the great salvation that He has given us? What does God expect for us? We could write a list 10 miles long, I suppose, if we really let our human minds run rampant about what God expects of us. Every religious group, every church would have a different list. Well, this is what we got to do. But really, all He wants is for us to love Him. And if we do that, we fulfill all the laws of God. And He said, the second is kind of like the first. And He issued His two commandments. He said, love your neighbor like you love yourself. So, when we look at the world we're living in, we see all these things happening. Midst of all the difficulties of life and turmoil, Peter reminds us of three things that he reminded his people on his day. We should have a living hope, and we do as Christians. We have this enduring faith that can't be destroyed. And we're captivated by the love of God that He sent His Son into the world, died on the cross for our sins. And we love Him because He first loved us. I have a song, give an invitation this morning.